Well, okay. Welcome, everybody. My name is Brother Mitch Metzger. I have been serving in the Philippines as a missionary for about 32 years. I became a Christian or a follower of Jesus about 36 years ago while stationed with the U.S. Marine Corps in Memphis, Tennessee. My job before I became a missionary was repairing airplanes, an avionics technician for 4 years. And then God spoke to me about going into all the world, making disciples. And so I've been now to about 27 countries doing missions activity and training, as well as evangelistic activity in all 50 states of America. I'm married to a Filipina named Liberty, and I have two daughters, age 23 and 18, in which both of them have completed their discipleship training schools and other training with Youth with a Mission in years past. And so I am currently now in my room here in Surabaya, Indonesia, with a team doing a mission outreach and training, teaching for about 28 days in Indonesia before returning back to the Philippines in March of 2020. So my good friend Welwel Malibiran has asked me to address 20 questions on leadership, strategies in leadership, and which I enjoy doing, love doing it. I said I'll type it all out, my answers, as well as make a video so that I can use this for future purposes as well. But Welwel and myself were classmates in a school of frontier missions with an organization called Youth with a Mission many, many years ago, I believe in the 90s. And so we've kept in touch up until today. But the first question on this questionnaire is the organization which I lead. Well, I'll answer that in two ways. First of all, the organization in which I'm currently with is called Youth with a Mission, YWAM. Started in 1960 by Lauren Cunningham with a vision of mobilizing young people into all of the world, doing evangelism, training, and mercy ministries. And so there's as many as 40,000 of us now in every country of the world, starting about one church every day somewhere in the world. And I am part of this movement or organization since 1988. And so, but on the more ground grassroots level, I am part of a leadership team of four of the Anti-Polo Training Center, which is found on the outskirts of Metro Manila, Philippines, near Marikina. And we have a training center with approximately 32 volunteers doing evangelism training and mercy ministry also. So many of the questions I'm going to answer with my an international hat on, as well as a local hat, meaning YWAM International and then YWAM Anti-Polo Training Center. I think the majority of my answers are going to come from my role on the leadership team of four from the Anti-Polo Training Center, in which I share leadership with three other ladies, and I'm the only guy. I am not the main chairman or leader of the center, which is led by Ling Ling Plaza, but I'm one of the leadership team members for many years now. But the organization which we lead is a Youth with a Mission, YWAM. The nature of our organization is evangelism, training, and mercy ministry. I think we have over 30 ships now, mercy ships, among the barco or boats that go island to island around the world with medical personnel, evangelistic personnel, church worker personnel, serving the nation. So this is the nature of our organization. It's a Christian organization. The objectives of our organization, obviously, are to preach the gospel, bring the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ into every nation through the mediums in which I just mentioned, evangelism, training, and mercy ministry. Number three, what do we got here? What are our objectives? We seek to bring the gospel of the Lord Jesus to every nation and discipling the peoples in their specific spheres of engagement, such as arts and entertainment, science and technology, from journalism to government to church life and family life. We are engaging these different spheres of the society in which we seek to reach in order to disciple the whole nation, whether it's technology or education or other. Okay, YWAM International, I'll give you a basic mission vision statement of us as an organization international, which is pretty much the same, of course, all the way down to grassroots centers, in which there's over 1,800 centers around the world today. I think we have about 30,000 volunteers that come to us every year for 6 months, 3 months, 20 days, 1 year, and then they go back to their normal jobs or their churches, etc. But we run a base of volunteer operations of anywhere between 21,000 as high as 40,000 full-time volunteers around the world. Okay, let me read a portion of our vision and mission statement, okay, taken directly from the website at ywam.org. That's ywam.org. Here we go. Youth of the Mission, or YWAM in short, is a global movement of Christians from many denominations. Yeah, we are interdenominational, dedicated to presenting Jesus personally to this generation, mobilize as many as possible to help in the task and to training and equipping of believers for their part in fulfilling the Great Commission, like what we're doing here in Indonesia now. Yesterday I met with 50 pastors from the provincial areas, and many of them are involved in ministry amongst unreached people groups of Indonesia. And so I gave them a basic challenge to continue to reach beyond their borders to even more unreached peoples in their midst. And this is part of what Youth with a Mission does, mobilizing the body of Christ for greater mission, greater giving, greater praying, greater going, greater training, etc. The sixth question on this questionnaire dealt with what are the needs of our organization? No, let me go back to number five. How many people do I lead? Well, in our center in Antipolo, I mentioned earlier, we have between 30 and 32 volunteers in our center, involved in many different ministries that will come up later on the questionnaire. Okay, so about 30 to 32. The name, what is the need of our organization that requires leadership? Every part of our organization requires leadership, from the kitchen to the market driver to maintenance to training, from children ministries. I think of the 70, I think it's 72 children from four particular squatter or poor areas in which we are helping with their sponsorship program for their education. So we need leadership in the children ministry. We need leadership with the youth. We need leadership with the almost 80 to 100 mothers that we interact with on an annual basis, driving teams, from picking up teams at the airport, from leadership in admin, accounting, banking, kitchen, maintenance, training, teaching, taking teams to the province. I think of a team right now as I'm talking in the Mauban Quezon area. They're serving an area that we are planting a church and have been planting a church for a couple years now. So we need a leadership that can lead church planting teams, evangelism teams, worship teams. The list goes on and on. So these are some of the our needs in our organization that requires leadership. Basically, every area. The profile of our organization found in number 7 on the questionnaire. Generally, we are still young, under 30 years old. The majority of our 30 volunteers are under 30, and then we have a large middle category up until about, oh, I'd say 40, and then there's maybe, less than 15, less than 12 of us that are 45 and above. Yeah, okay. So we have a good section of every age group in our center. Okay, but primarily we are called Youth with a Mission and try to champion young people to rise up and fulfill their destiny in Christ Jesus. We have about 70%. We are a heavy female base at our center, a lot of ladies. Our leadership is lady. As I mentioned earlier, 3 of our leadership team are ladies and myself. That is not always normal on centers around the Philippines or around the world. It just happens to be our particular profile, about 70% female. Economic status of most of our staff, I would say high school, college graduates, straight from their schooling into our training, and now everyone is basically a full-time fundraiser as well as a full-time volunteer. But we're not poor, although sometimes we're praying for our next 1,000 pesos for outreach or for our trip. But we don't consider ourselves a poor agency or organization as well as individuals. I would say we're middle, not rich, but we're in middle class, and God provides, and it's amazing when we total up all of our totals at the end of the year, of airplane tickets we have had to purchase and trips we've gone on and repairs we've had to do on the building, etc. It's amazing how God has provided for us, but we're not like a five-star hotel stayers every night, you know what I mean? Okay, I think you got the idea. Next question is number 8. What is the strength? Oh, sorry. A little bit about our religious affiliation. Of course, Christian, born again Christian. Most of us are Pentecostal background, but not everybody. So that should give you a little taste of who we are. The 8th question, what is the strength of my leadership in particular? Well, when I first started in Youth with a Mission, my primary strength was evangelism. Evangelism, 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 going out in the streets, preaching, primarily in a discipleship of females in a home for girls back in the 80s and 90s. But as I've been progressing through my career as a missionary, I've seen my own giftings or profile change to where my primary strengths are in actual leadership and admin, I can't believe it, but admin, administration, and then evangelism has taken a third place. So those are my strengths. I find it easy to start things. I've started discipleship training weeks. I've led discipleship training schools. I've started schools of evangelism in Sweden as well as the Philippines. I've run like 13 of them already. We started one in Nigeria through some of our disciples. We started one in Norway through one of our disciples. I've also led almost 36 Suge outdoor adventure leadership courses in Cebu, Davao, Naga, Subic Bay, as well as Tanay Province, Rizal. And so helped start a base in Tacloban, start a church in Bukidnon, start a church in Mauban Quezon, start a church in Tacloban City after a Yolanda crisis. So starting things and initiating things, you know, this basic, apostolic type gifting has been natural for me. Starting, seeing things moving forward, this type of a thing. So that has always been my strength and my enjoyment and excitement. Some of the weaknesses, I suppose, of my leadership would be in the pastoral care of certain volunteers, which require, you know, active listening, counseling, discussing their problem, whatever, this type of a healing of, you know, their situation. I don't consider myself this type of an active listener for, you know, super duper medical counseling, you know, where it requires a lot of time with one person. I operate more in judgment and black and white, and I can see, okay, this is your problem, this is what you need to fix, this is where it's at. So I'm good at distinguishing where their problem is, but often lack the compassionate mercy type giftings required to really, you know, bring them through in a nice way. So I've noticed when I'm partnered with a great counselor, it's really, really great. My prophetic, black and white, you know, sin, you know, is the problem or whatever, you know, this type of a directness is often coupled very warmly and successfully with those that are quite mercy minded and mercy ministry. So I would say that would be one of my weaknesses. Okay, very exciting. Number 10. But to make a further note, it's interesting that the longer you're in leadership and the longer and the more experience you have, and as you get older, obviously, even your weaknesses begin to rise up to a healthy balance. And so I've seen that one improve a lot over the last 30 years. Okay, number 10 on the questionnaire, how do you deal with problems? How do you deal with problems? Well, I guess it depends on what the problem is, of course, but often I will, if I run into a problem that I can't solve very easily as I'm seeking the Lord, often I will just message or console with other leadership. There are many in our organization that have more years of experience than me, especially in the area of like titling or banking or immigration questions or paperwork questions about legal government forms or something that is all maybe a new territory for me to explore. Those types of problems are often quickly solved through simple, getting advice from others that have gone through those things before, have already knew what office to visit or what line to stand in. So I haven't had a big problem solving problems because of the wide range of people that God has allowed me to be in partnership with, and you can usually get answers to stuff, even from minutes to before the day is finished. So I haven't really considered solving my problems to be even a problem, to be honest with you. I remember I can give an example of this. I remember because in number 10, running over to number 11, it asks how to deal with problems, or how do I deal with challenge. Well, I've often been, quite a competitive person anyhow. I like a good challenge. I like a good fight, I like to, head on, David is a hero of mine, yeah, let's get Goliath, yeah. And so I haven't, I'm not the type that will flee or run or hide, so my personality profile, if you're familiar with that, like the 16 personality profiles, very exciting test you can take on the internet. I come out as a chief, and so I enjoy a good challenge, enjoy a good problem to solve. I remember once I was leading a team to we were driving to Tacloban, and my minibus overheated on a high point of the hill of the mountain, climbing, the engine, basically the head gasket blew off, because it got overheated. So, I think I had, 5 or 6 or 7 people with me. So I had to figure out, what to do with them. Okay, so I helped with housing for them, and eventually had them transfer to a church in Tacloban where they could, basically had 4 days off, while I, along with a mechanic that I found 14 kilometers away, we dived into that engine and we began to bring it back to action again. Everything from the, engine repair on the side of the highway. I would sleep in the bus at night, and in the morning the mechanic would come again and we'd work again. I'd help him, hand him the wrenches and everything. So that's how I often deal with challenges. If it's a flat tire or whatever, I'm the first one to get out and look for the tools and start cranking those nuts off, and just diving in, going after, attacking the challenges, and I get great satisfaction with the victory that comes with these tasks, mga trabajo, or these mga challenges accomplished. And so I get great satisfaction with being victorious, and coming out at the end, and with, the tire's been changed, the engine's been fixed, and okay, everybody get in the bus again, let's go, yeah! Okay, so challenges, amen, bring it on, praise God. 11, how do you do? Okay, 12, where is Jesus in your leadership? Where is Jesus in my leadership? Well, if I was asked where Jesus is in my leadership, how would I answer that? I'm an idea person. I'm not so much, I don't get like dreams and visions so much. But often God has spoken to me in the past and still does through ideas. I'm naturally a linear type person anyhow. And so God really speaks to me often in a linear, make sense, common sense, idea type of way, creative way. And so Where's Jesus? Well, God speaks to me in that manner. Often he speaks to me in the form of ideas that work. If engaged in, I will progress through that day or that week or that month or that year. His guidance is not that complicated often for me. Simply following tried and true principles often work every time, with only minor adjustments along the way. I think of when I was in Orlando, Florida once, I was, I think, cleaning some storage rooms or something on a Youth of the Mission Center there. And as I opened up one particular storage cabinet or closet or whatever, I found these cases, like four cases of Spanish New Testaments. And they'd been sitting there for many years, you could tell. And so I approached the leadership and I said, "Hey, what are you doing with these Spanish Bibles? What's your plan for them? You have any plan for them?" "Oh, I don't know." And then I began to get these ideas. "Well, why not? Let's distribute these. Let's give them away." And what's on your mind? It was at that moment that I was inspired with an idea to make a sign, you know, free Spanish Bibles. So I made a sign quite big, and I got myself a small ladder, and I went out to the nearest intersection, and I set up this ladder with my sign on top of it, facing the cars coming at the red light. And so free Spanish Bibles. And so I stood on the corner, I had the Bibles, I got myself a construction apron where you put your nails and your bolts and your hammer in, and I filled it up with Bibles, And so I stood on that corner, and as cars would pull up at the red light, many of them would start rolling down their windows, or they would honk and then roll down their windows, and I started, you know, passing out these free Spanish Bibles to people in their cars at the red light. And as it turned green, boom, they would honk, thank you, And then I'd wait for the next red light again. And so within just a few hours, I was able to distribute all of these Bibles. And I also motivated the other volunteers that were watching me, you know, thinking, "Wow, look at what Brother Mitch is doing. Hey, let's join him. This looks like fun." And so they began to join in, and they were pretty soon helping, also going car to car, row to row, you know, giving away these Bibles. And so this was very exciting and a sample of number 12 question of where is Jesus in my leadership. Number 13, what is excellency in leadership? Well, excellency, you know, I remember reading a book once and it talked about excellency in leadership. And I remember the sample it gave in the book is often a sample that we often practice in our organization as well, but it's in the area of being faithful in the small things. I remember once a preacher, Bonifacio from Victory Christian Fellowship, he once said, "If God can't trust you to keep your shoes polished, how can God trust you with four brand new rubber tires of a Mitsubishi Pajero?" In other words, it was a challenge to be faithful in the small things. This is excellency in leadership, whether it's pulling out the garbage can, cleaning behind it, pulling out the refrigerator, cleaning behind it, you know, ironing your shirt, keeping your church clean and the entrance line. Excellency, you know, being accurate with your records, your bookkeeping, taking care of your stuff, returning borrowed items, paying off a debt, paying your bills first, fixing something you break. This is excellency in leadership. I'll give you an example. Of 2016, I was in America and I had to borrow a car from a church friend for my American trip. So I went about 30,000 miles, that's like 60,000 kilometers. I went through like 30 states. I stayed in 65 homes. I was speaking in maraming churches, many churches all across the country, visiting supporters and friends, etc., etc. And so, of course, I put a lot of time or a lot of miles on that vehicle. And so, like my normal habit, when I returned the vehicle, I washed it, I detailed it, I didn't just tire black the tires, but I sprayed the engine, I detailed the engine, the under chassis. I went to the mall and I bought some brand new floor mats, nice Chevy, Chevrolet floor mats, yellow and black, beautiful rubber mats. and I got a nice Chevy steering wheel cover, and I armor all, polished all the vinyl in the car, and then I returned it to the owner, and it was beautiful. The car was like immaculate, just like new, you know. And this is excellency in leadership. Yeah, this is God's heart. This is how we are to live. Amen. Okay. Number 14. What is mediocrity in leadership, or half-heartedness in leadership? Well, it's the opposite of what I just said. Yeah. Not attempting to upgrade yourself or improve yourself, or, you know, or clean that corner for the longest time. It's a pastor or a worker that is satisfied, or a company manager that is satisfied, or a teacher in a school that is just satisfied with the norm, not seeking to upgrade or improve or add some more flowers or fix this bench or, you know, paint this wall. This is mediocrity in leadership, where there's no desire to go on. It's like a pastor in the same church for 30 years with the same 30 people, with no, and everything's happy, but there's no seeking of reaching the regions beyond. No daughter church desire, no cell group desire, no more fresh home groups, no more new cities to target, no more new province, no mission trips, no praying, no giving, no going, no training for the final frontiers, for regions beyond. And so from that is mediocrity in leadership. I think of story I'll tell you a little bit later. Number 15, what do we got here? What is the cultural context of your leadership? Well, of course, I've been living in the Philippines for 32 years now. So primarily, I operate in and out of a Filipino-American, Phil-Am context, and especially in the Metro Manila urban area. So a lot of my leadership styles is, it's still very, you know, corporate American, go, 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 urban, yeah, style with a Filipino virus. Okay, I don't know how else to explain that, but since I've been in Asia, I can't help but adjust in many areas, and I can adjust and adapt to some extreme situations, but primarily, I'm still, you know, urban, city, Phil-Am, cultural context, leadership style. Okay, number 16. What is leadership as a social exercise? Is leadership a social exercise? Is leadership a social exercise? Well, for sure, leadership has to be interacting with your people, meeting with your people, discussing things, even having the humility to sit back and get their ideas. What do you think? What do you think we should do? What do you think we need to change? Okay, that's an interesting thought. So for sure, leadership requires social interaction with our people. I'll tell you what it is. It is not. It is not what I experienced about 3 weeks ago when I arrived in Indonesia. I was talking to one of our church workers, and I said, hey, can we visit your office someday? Because she works in an office, like a distribution center. They distribute something. I'm not sure what they distribute. But anyhow, I said, she's an accountant, okay, in the office. Boring job. Anyhow, I said, hey, can we visit your office someday and see where you work and see your desk and kind of get familiar with, you know, who your coworkers are? And I don't know, we're just, this would be interesting for us to visit where you work and kind of get to know, you know, what you do when you're not here at church. And she said, oh, I don't know if I can do that. I said, yeah, that'd be interesting for us. You know, we could even meet your boss and say hello to him. Just a friendly visit. Maybe we could even bring some snacks and give to everybody. And she said, oh, I don't know. I don't know if my boss would like that, because he doesn't really come into the office. I said, what do you mean he doesn't come into the office? And she said, oh, we sometimes don't see him for days and days at a time. He's in, you know, this office, and we're in this office, but he doesn't come in there. He doesn't come to talk to us. He's I won't tell you what country he's from, but he was from a different country, not an Indonesian. But the style of leadership she described, I was thinking, are you serious? That's terrible. So, you know, he's not involved in their lives. It's total corporate, you know, like no interaction with your employees. My goodness, that's, I mean, that is terrible. And so that is a bad example of a social leadership as a social exercise. No. We're to interact with them like Jesus did. He ate with his disciples and talked with them, and they slept on the same floor on outreach. Amen. Whether you're a bank manager or a church leader, it's, you need to, you know, be with your employees and talk to them and have lunch break with them, etc. This is basic and simple. Okay, number, where are we at? 17, almost finished. We've got 20 here. Number 17, is leadership a spiritual exercise? Well, of course it is. Whether you're a bank manager, a garbage truck driver, mayor, principal of a school, pastor of a school, of a church, it is to be spiritual. We are to always seek God's voice, get direction from Him, guidance from Him, and make decisions based on His leading in our life and for our people, for problem solving, etc. This will include a framework, of course, of morality and servant leadership in dealing with our group. So, yeah, leadership is obviously, should be a spiritual exercise. A Christian company is always going to be, you know, different, or at least in theory should be different than a, you know, an atheist, non-Christian, God-hating company. You get the idea. I'll give you an example of this. When I was not a Christian, back in the 70s and early 80s, I became a Christian in 84 at the age of 20. But before I became a Christian, I was in the restaurant business for 6 years, from age 14 all the way to age 20 before I joined the military. And so from dishwasher, cook, and assistant manager, we had about 50 employees in the restaurant. So all, even during high school, I'm like supervising, you know, my classmates. My classmates in school were often my employees in the restaurant. Amazing. I was not a Christian. But I remember dealing with the employees, you know, in a non-Christian way also. I mean, if someone was too slow, or someone's too late, you know, or their attitude we didn't like, or whatever, a little bit rebel, we would fire people. We often didn't counsel them so much. We didn't like bring them into the office and, you know, hey Joe, you know, what's the problem? Is everything okay at home? Are you having any difficulties with your family? You seem to be bothered by something, you know. We didn't really care about that stuff, the background of why their attitude is bad or why they're late, you know. And so when we didn't like somebody and they weren't performing, we just fired them. You know, hey Joe, hey, this is your last day. I want you gone in 10 minutes. You know, this style of leadership. What? Yeah, you're fired. You're gone. I'm tired of your attitude, tired of you being late. And, you know, I've told you a million times to speed up when the orders start coming in. Come on, you're out. That's it. You're done in 15 minutes. Okay? That was the style, you know. That was the norm. I'm embarrassed now to know how. What an amazing difference it would have made to be a Christian in those days of leadership, where, you know, there was some compassion and concern and care, where, you know, rather than just firing them, you could help them become a whole person and a, you know, a renewed person, a complete person, rather than just someone, you know, an employee that is just, you know, a worker. You get my point? So, for sure, leadership is to be spiritual. Okay. And number 18, almost done. Here we go. Is leadership an intellectual exercise? So we touched on social, spiritual, now intellectual. Of course, big time. And leadership is highly intellectual, since all of your choices, habits, character, and the destiny of your direction or company or ministry results in how we think. And so leaders need to be readers, and readers are said to be leaders. You can't be a leader if you're not reading. You can't be, because it's your mind that controls your choices and your habits. Matter of fact, in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, I have it right here, not to be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So Paul challenges, we need to renew, we need to upgrade, we need to keep educating, we need to keep informing, we need to keep feeding our mind, obviously with good things. Why? That we may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And so in leadership, we want to know the perfect will of God. What is good? What is acceptable? And to do that, we have to renew our mind. And how can we renew our mind? By changing our thinking. How can we change our thinking? By reading, by studying, by watching, by observing, by, you know, upgrading ourselves continually. In Youth of the Mission, our organization, we don't just practice like a four-year Bible school type of a program, but education is a lifetime. All of our courses are 3 months, 3 months, 6 months, 3 months, 6 months, 3 months, 3 months, 6 months. So you learn a little and use it a lot, and then learn some more and then use it a lot. And then, so it's learn and apply, or, learn and do. Yeah, and then learn some more, do it. Learn some more, and then do it. So your whole life you'll be spending learning and developing intellectually based on your passion or your focus or what it is you're wanting to hit the mark in. Basic, yeah? Number 19, almost finished. Is leadership less spiritual in a secular context or environment? Is leadership less spiritual in a secular environment rather than context or environment? Here's my answer to that. Often leadership is less spiritual in a secular context, but God never intended it to be this way. Whether you're a car salesman, a balut vendor, that's a duck egg salesman, or banking cashier, we are to come underneath the lordship of Jesus and allow every step to be ordered by the Lord. The individual city or nation that practices this will be blessed, will be great, and will be honored and favored by God. So whether you're a bank cashier or a pastor, listen to this. There is no difference between secular and spiritual. This is actually going to answer number 20 as well. We need to break this down and get people to have a revelation that whatever they are doing, are you listening? Whatever they're doing, whether they're selling fish or planting churches, it's a spiritual endeavor to seek God, seek His will, learn to hear His voice, and then do it with all of their heart, not as unto man, but as unto Him. This is an amazing revelation that needs to happen. Number 20, in leadership, is leadership more spiritual in a clerical type context? I just answered that in number 19. We should not separate the two. We are to bring it all together. Whether you're sweeping the floor or whether you're leading worship, it's a spiritual exercise and needs to be offered unto the Lord. A good example of this is when I was in the military before I became a full-time Christian preacher. I was fixing airplanes. My job was an avionics technician, airplane technician, airplane electronics, okay, electrician for airplanes. And so I was a Christian as a military airplane technician. So as my coworkers were just fixing only, I, for money, for paycheck, for, you know, pay their bills, I was fixing and doing my job as unto the Lord, you see? And when you do it that way, there's actually joy and gladness and victory and success and fulfillment because you're doing it as unto Him. And so He's blessing you. And so whether you're, you know, I seen my job as a minister of God. I was an ambassador for the Lord Jesus Christ on the airplanes. So whether I was cleaning airplanes, I remember those days standing on the top of the airplane with a brush, washing airplanes in freezing rain. washing, from washing garbage cans to mopping airplane hangar decks from greasy hydraulic fluid. Whether it was mopping or scrubbing the top of the airplane, I was a minister, I was a preacher, I was an ambassador for Jesus on the plane in the military. So whether my eyes are on the target or cleaning up hydraulic fluid or going to church or going to the Bible study in the barracks, it was all spiritual activity as far as I was concerned and as far as heaven was concerned. And it needs to be the same for you also. Thank you for this opportunity to share with you. I hope you're inspired unto good works. Amen. Be not weary in well-doing, for in due season, you shall reap and I shall reap if we faint not. Okay? From Indonesia, this is Brother Mitch. God bless you all.